Hello and welcome to the TI Precision Labs. Clock buffers are one of the most common circuits and may be found in just about any electronic systems, from the mobile phone in your pocket to a satellite in deep space. This block diagram shows the basic clock buffer concept, which is to accept an input and distribute multiple copies of the input at its output. At a very high level, a clock buffer can be divided into three parts: input, distribution, and outputs. A buffer might include a logic control block for optional features like output channel enable-disable, input muxing, or device configuration. Let's explore what key parameters to look for in a buffer. The voltage supply for a buffer is usually one of two types, single supply or dual supply. Single supply requires one VDD domain, such as 3.3 volts, 2.5 volts, or 1.8 volt. A single VDD supply rail, however, can make it difficult to level translate from input to output. Dual supply is broken up into the core supply and the output supply, which provides advantages for level translation as well as better isolation between inputs and outputs. The trade-off for a dual supply is it requires multiple VDD domains with supply filtering on both domains, particularly for performance-sensitive applications. Clock buffers can either accept single-ended signals or differential signals or both. The most common signal type for single-ended is CMOS, and differential you'll see a variety of LVDS, HCSL, CML, and LVPECL applications. Single-ended clock buffers have easier trace routing and generally need fewer termination resistors, but can be lacking in noise immunity. Noise from other signals or ground can easily couple into the signal path, thereby degrading performance. Differential signals, by their nature, provide rejection of common mode noise and inherently cancel even order harmonics. A PCB designer does need to take more care when routing to ensure differential traces are matched for best noise immunity. Universal buffers are another versatile alternative and can input-output both single-ended and differential formats at the cost of some additional internal circuitry. Important specifications for single-ended clock inputs include VIH, which indicates a logic high, and VIL, which indicates a logic low. The difference between VIH and VIL is defined as noise margin, and the higher this margin, the more tolerant the system is to noise events. The faster the edge or slew rates also will improve the system jitter performance in both single-ended and differential clock buffers. For differential clock inputs, there are similar important specifications for input levels, like differential input voltage peak to peak, or VICM, the input common mode voltage, which sets the voltage threshold between logic 0 and logic 1. Important specifications for clock outputs would be VOH, VOL, or output high voltage and low voltage thresholds. And for differential clock buffer outputs, you have Vout, differential peak to peak. Just like for the input, a common mode differential output voltage is defined as well, VOS, also known as V-cross or AC reference voltage. For both output types, you'll want to pay attention to the output impedance Rout, the impedance looking into the output of the device. For a CMOS single-ended signal, the various output levels are indicated in the first row here. Not surprisingly, since it swings rail to rail, the mid voltage is half of VDD. For the LVDS differential signal type, you have a typical 700 millivolt swing around a 1.2 volt common mode voltage. Next up is the LVPECL differential signal, with even higher swing and a low impedance output referenced to VDD. HCSL clock buffers are gaining popularity these days for distributing PCIe signals. HCSL waveform has a VOL of 0 volts or ground. And you can find many types of CML clock buffers, often with slight variations in output swing. The output phase noise profile of a buffer consists of the input phase noise to the buffer and the phase noise of the buffer itself. The plot shown on the left is that of the reference to TI's CMOS buffer LMK1C110X. The plot on the right is the output of the device. From the comparison, we see the additive jitter is negligible. Any phase noise plot has primarily two types of noise associated with it: low frequency offset noise and thermal noise, wideband. The low frequency offset noise is usually associated with flicker noise, sometimes called 1 over F noise because its noise power is inversely proportional to the frequency. The other important type of noise is the thermal noise, which has a uniform noise power spectrum. It's associated with resistors, transistors, and other such elements. Jitter and phase noise sensitivity in a buffer differs depending on signal swing and architecture. Higher input signal swing is better. The higher the input slew rate, the lower the jitter and the phase noise. From a system level, higher output slew rate is also better for system jitter or phase noise performance. Higher output loading can sometimes degrade performance. The clock tree here shows a typical case where there might be a system-level setup timing concern. Propagation delay, TPD, from input to output is crucial for system timing. A higher propagation delay may result in a longer setup time or limit the maximum frequency of operation. Here we see a scope shot of a clock buffer input and output waveforms measuring the propagation delay. The measured clock buffer is non-inverting, so the prop delay is measured from the rising edge of the input to the rising edge of the output, resulting in a delay of about 10.8 nanoseconds. Remember to subtract the delays from the test setup PCB trays or cables for accurate calibration. For this figure, all of the output waveforms have good alignment, which is called channel-to-channel skew. Low skew is important for distributing accurate clocks to multiple places. Buffers are often used to distribute clocks to ADCs connected in parallel to enable higher resolution. In such an application, care must be taken to ensure that the channel-to-channel skew satisfies the allowable clock variation, meeting the ADC device aperture delay specifications. When multiple buffers are used, the device-to-device skew for the selected clock distribution buffers becomes important also to keep the timing and synchronization across multiple ADC devices. Power consumption in buffers is dependent on multiple parameters specific to the use case. Frequency of operation, output loading, VDD, number of outputs active can all play a role. Power consumption is also dependent on the type of architecture used in the buffer, namely current or voltage mode. Power consumption in voltage mode architectures increases with the frequency of operation. A CMOS buffer would be one example. Power consumption in current mode architectures, such as LVPECL, is usually independent of frequency. The term output load refers to any connection that is made to the output. It can have a significant impact on the AC performance of the buffer, potentially affecting output amplitude, rise time, fall time, propagation delay, output skew, and even RMS jitter. We'll discuss more about the different output types and proper loading in another Precision Labs. That concludes this video on key parameters and specifications for a clock buffer. Thank you for watching. Please test your knowledge of the material with a simple four-question quiz to wrap up. If you need more information or technical resources on TI clocks and timing products, please visit ti.com and type in /clocks.